next talk is by Anne Longeau from University of the Basque Country in Bilbao, and she's going to tell us about its alternative for the Cremona Group. Please, Anne.
Thank you for the introduction, Alain, and thank you to the organizer to invite me to give a talk at this conference. It's a great honor for me to be here. So I am working on the Cremona Group, but I didn't prove the TITS alternative for the Cremona Group. But still, I think it was the topic to give today. So this is a work, initially by Kanta, then it has been extended to by Uresh, and then recently by Lamy and Urech. So I will tell you. So after the night's talk of Emmanuel, I will still recall just fast TITS alternative for completeness of the talk. And then I will introduce the Cremona Group because I guess that not so many people are used to it. So definition. So a group G satisfies the TITS alternative . So in my talk, I will not be interested only on a finitely generated subgroup, but also in any subgroup. So I will make a difference. So I will call it TITS alternative if the alternative holds for any subgroup, and TITS alternative for finitely generated subgroup. So satisfy the TITS alternative, respectively, the TITS alternative for finitely generated subgroups if G either is virtually if any subgroup of G and respectively any finitely generated subgroup of G is either virtually solvable or it contains a non-abelian free group. So as mentioned, Emmanuel before. So TITS proves this theorem for this alternative for linear groups. And so if we take any field, so then if the characteristic is zero, then GLN satisfies the TITS alternative for any subgroup. If the characteristic is positive, then it satisfies it for finitely generated subgroup. And so one remark is that in characteristic positive, it's not true that it satisfies the TITS alternative for any groups. So not possible to remove the condition on finitely. So already, if you take a finite field and you take the algebraic closure, this is not this doesn't satisfy the TITS alternative. But on the other hand, if the field is finite, it's really easy to see that it satisfies it for finitely generated subgroup. So Okay, so this was my end. So it will be the same kind of statement for the Cremona group. So I will define the Cremona group. So the Cremona group is a group coming from algebraic geometry. And in algebraic geometry, to classify algebraic varieties, well, we don't do it at up to isomorphism because it's really too rigid, and the good notion is up to variational transformation. So I would just define what is a variational transformation. So let S and S prime surfaces over K. So for me, surfaces will be projective variety of dimension 2 here. And so F, which goes from S to S prime, is a birational transformation. If you can find two open, one of S and one of S prime, open dense. So open for the Zariski topology. So in the case of surface, it means that you can remove a finite number of curves or points, such that F induces an isomorphism between U and U prime. So what you have to have in mind is that isomorphism in algebraic geometry are locally given by polynomials, and in this case to be given by quotient of polynomials. And if S and S prime are the same surface, then you have a group, the group of birational transformation, and the Cremona group is when this surface is the projective plane. So I will denote it by Bir P2. The Cremona group is the group of birational transformation. Of P2. So before giving some example of elements or subgroup of the Cremona group, I will just state the theorem that we are interested today. So the theorem is by Kanta, which is Urer, and let's say Lem Urer. Let K be a field, and we have the same statements, but for the Cremona group. So if the characteristic is zero, then the Cremona group satisfies the tilt alternative. And in the positive characteristic case, it satisfies it, but for finitely generated subgroups. So this is my talk will be about this theorem. And so, before going my aim will be to give a sketch of this proof. But I want to do some comments. So first of all, this theorem is not an immediate consequence of the theorem of Titz, because Cremona group are not linear. So remark, this was done by Cornulier. I think it's in an unpublished note, but by Cornulier that Bir P2 is not linear over the algebraic closure. And then I will just let you know what is a bit the history of this theorem is that in fact, Kanta proved that Bir P2 satisfies the Titz alternative for C and for finitely generated subgroups.
What do you mean by it's not linear?
You don't embed it in a linear group. Yeah. So. Okay. So. What Kanta prove? He proved it for finitely generated subgroup. So for. And over C. But okay, let's say that this proof works over characteristic zero. And Urer, he did also over C, but then he removes the assumption of finitely generated group, subgroup. And the main problem was torsion group. So we have torsion, unbounded torsion group in the Cremona group. And this was making the thing more difficult in the proof for Urer. But this we'll see it when it will appear in the sketch of the proof. So for any subgroup. And then in the book on the web page of Stéphane Lamy, which is still not finished, they extended this alternative also in the positive positive characteristic case. And this will see also what were the where was the problem in the talk. So and I wanted to say also that so this theorem is proved, and so you can also ask the question for a group of higher dimensions, so BRP3, BRP4, and so on, and this is still unknown. So the Cremona group BRP2 is quite well known now. But in higher dimension, really few is known about the structure of this group. So recently, it has been really a breakthrough. And Blanc, Lamy, and Zimmermann, they prove that BRPN, for m greater than 2, is not a simple group. But we don't know so much about the structure of the group. So it's it's an open question whether in higher dimension, it satisfies this alternative or not. Okay, so now let's go a bit more in the Cremona group. So I will give you example of subgroups of the Cremona group, and with a focus on which group will be interesting for the Tietz alternative. So. So if you take an element in the Cremona group, it has this form, so it goes from P2 to P2 and to X, Y, Z. We can associate a homogeneous polynomial of the same degree. And we can remove if they have common factor, non-constant common factor. So in fact, this is rational, and to be rational, you want an inverse of the same form. So for those who it's the first time you saw it, you can see that there are points which are not well defined. So if you take the common zero of the three homogeneous polynomial, this is the point which is not defined. And you can also contract some, it's also possible to contract some curves, but if you remove these curves contracted and these points where it's not well defined, then it's an isomorphism. And and what we call the degree of F is the degree of the Fi. So now, one of the subgroups, it will not appear in the Tietz alternative, but the first subgroup we want to understand is the group of automorphism of P2, so where everything is well defined, it's really automorphism. And this, in fact, they are the birational transformation of degree 1. So this means that your three polynomials are homogeneous polynomials of degree 1. You want to be inversible, and you are in P2, so this is isomorphic to PGL3. So now another subgroup I want to focus on is a group which is called the Juncker group. And this will be one of the main block of the, for the tilted alternative. So in fact, the game will be then we will see that it acts on a hyperbolic space. And the game will be that understanding the isometries, either we'll find directly that it's some subgroup satisfies the tilted alternative, or we'll embed them in some groups that we already know that satisfy the tilted alternative. So my key groups will be the following one. So first we have the Juncker group. So this is, so I will call it Junk. And this is PGL2 K of Y. PGL2 K. And this group, in fact, they are the group that preserves the pencil of. So if you take the point, so if you have Z equals 0, Y equals 0. So this is P2. This group is a group that preserves the pencil of line passing through this point. So a pencil of line is parameterized by P1. And so these maps, they will send the pencil of line passing through this point to the pencil of line passing through this point. Just note that, well, usually a line should be sent to a curve of the degree of the Fi, generic line. But they have the specificity that these lines, they will be sent to lines. And in fact, these factors, this factor here act on the P1 parameterizing the lines, and this one acts on each line. Okay, and so if the characteristic is zero, then, okay, by the adjoint representation, you have an embedding of PGL2 into GL3. And so these two factors are linear, so they satisfy the TITS alternative by the result of TITS. And so the group itself is satisfied the TITS alternative. Okay, so if characteristic is zero, by the theorem of TITS, So Junk also satisfies it. And now we'll see. So now the problem in positive characteristic is that it's not because you have some groups where the two factors satisfy the TITS alternative for finitely generated subgroup, but not the whole group. So this is the main. Problem, in fact, in the positive characteristic. So attention, if you have one. And they both satisfied TITS alternative for finitely generated subgroup. It's not true anymore that G satisfied. So this doesn't imply G satisfies. But it turns out that with a mild assumption on the field, Urer and Lamy succeeded to contour this problem. And surprisingly, with this mild assumption, they proved that this group will satisfy the TITS alternative even not for a finitely generated subgroup, so for any subgroups. So, proposition. So, okay, maybe I will put it here like this. I will keep it for later on. So, we have Junk. So, in characteristic zero, satisfies the TITS alternative.
And in characteristic, in positive characteristic, if k, so the assumption on the k will be that k is finitely generated extension of fp. So if the characteristic is p, so the field with p elements. So if you have a finitely generated extension of fp, then Jonc satisfy the Tietz alternative. So another group I want to speak about, another subgroup that we will need later on, is the Toric-Cremona group. So it so you have an embedding of k star square into P2 by x, y, 1. Oh, sorry. X, y is sent to x, y, 1. And the Toric-Cremona group is a group of automorphism on this k. So this is a multiplicative group. And this is isomorphic to GL2, Z, semi-direct. Where, okay, GL2, Z acts on the following way. So to X, Y, we can associate it to X, A, Y, B, X, C, Y, D for A, B, C, D in GL2, Z. And okay, star. For alpha, beta, and K star. So I forgot now, I realized to mention that, so before I told you that a birational transformation can be seen as a locally quotient of polynomial, and this happens, for instance, if you take the last coordinate to be 1, and you mod out by this thing. So sometimes we like to write birational transformation as map from P2 to P2, and sometimes we like to write them locally. And so if I rewrite this locally, I put Z equals to 1, and I quotient by the last factor. And so this is F1 XY1 over F2 XY1 F0, sorry. Okay, so this is how I see these maps also inside the Cremona group. Okay, and then here we have the same. So this satisfies Tietz alternative. This is linear, it satisfies Tietz alternative. So our toric group satisfies Tietz alternative. And this is in any field for, because this, okay. Here in GLN, we don't have the problem of the positive characteristic because it's over Z. So now we have, so the toric Cremona group satisfies Tietz alternative for any field. And then the last one I want to introduce is a group of polynomial automorphism. So the automorphism of P2, of A2, so you remove the line at infinity. And this, there's a birational transformation, the Cremona transformation, that are written as a polynomial. So F, they are locally written as a, so X, Y, sent to F1, X, F2, X, Y, where
F1 and F2 are polynomial. And we want an inverse of the same form. And even if like this, it looks like it's an easy group. In fact, for instance, if the field is infinite, this contains a free product on a P1. So indexed by P1. So it contains a huge free product inside. So this is really already a really wild group. And this was a result by Lamy that the automorphism of A2 satisfies Tietz alternative. Well, okay, I will write it there, but it satisfies Tietz alternative for in characteristic zero and for finitely generated group in positive characteristic. And the main ingredient is that this is an amalgamated product of two subgroups, so it acts on the Basser tree. And then he played the game of on the tree. So, and we have automorphism of P2. So, satisfies Tietz alternative if the characteristic is zero and the Tietz alternative for finitely generated subgroups if the characteristic is positive. So now I will introduce the space on which the Cremona group acts on. And in fact, this space and this action have been really a powerful tool to study the Cremona group in rank 2. But sadly, this doesn't pass on higher dimension, and you will see why. So by lack of time, I will give you an idea of how it is constructed. I will not do it really precisely, but just to give you an idea of how it is constructed. So construction of H and C. So this space, it will be infinite dimensional model of the hyperbolic space, but with the hyperboloid model. So it's analog in infinite dimensional of H2, which is defined as x, y, z belonging to R3, such that x squared minus y squared minus z squared . So I will make you, okay, I will not build it really properly, but I will make you feel what will be this set and what will be this bilinear form. So definition. So a divisor on a surface is a formal sum finite sum. The coefficients are in Z, and these are irreducible curves on your surface. So this is what we call a divisor. And so what will be my bilinear form will be the intersection form. So if you have two curves in a general position, okay, here my construction is over an algebraically closed field. If you have two curves and they intersect transversely, you can just count the number of intersection points. And then there is also a theory like you have to count multiplicity if they don't intersect transversally. But this is well done. And for instance, if you allowed with this intersection to also do self-intersection. So for instance, the self-intersection of a line in P2, you can move it a bit. And then you see that if you move it a bit, then it's just one intersection point. So it will be one. So you have to have in mind that it's what you expect to be. So we have an intersection form on divisors. And the thing, I, so The thing I will be interested in will be the Neron Severi group. So the Neron Severi group of a surface S. This is a group of divisors modeled out by a numerical equivalence. So two divisors will be equivalent if and only if for any irreducible curve on S, D1 intersects C. Well, the intersection number between D1 and C and D2 and C is the same. So if we do just the example of what happens with P2. So you know by Bézout's theorem that if you intersect a curve, so in fact you do this intersection on curves and then you add by linearity. And so if you, by Bézout, you know that if you intersect any curves with a line, then the intersection number will be the degree of your curve. So this means that, in fact, on P2, you have just one generator, it's a line. So the Neron Severi group of P2 is generated by the line. Now, so if we have P2, so we have a line. If we take a point and you blow up this point, so it means you replace this point by a P1. Outside the P and the P1, it's an isomorphism. And here, when you have the line, well, any direction of line gives you a point here. So here you get a vibration over. So if you do this thing, the P1 you got, it's called exceptional divisor. And so now the Neron Severi group of this surface here, you have all the divisors coming from down. So you have still you have the line. But then you have a new one that you cannot express in front of the other one. So if I call this surface SP, then the Neron Severi group of SP, it's generated by the line and this exceptional divisor that we have created. And if we blow up two points, so because it's an isomorphism, if I look at the surface where I have blown two points, then it will be generated by this L, EP, and EQ. And the self-intersection of EP, or the self-intersection of EQ, is minus one. So now we have L squared is one, EP. And so here you see appearing your base for your, so if now I look at the Neron Severi, so if I tensorize by R, you start to see appearing this R3 here. So you have this R3 and this bilinear form. And what we do is that, in fact, we don't just do this thing, but we blow up all the points. So we take the inductive limit, so the ambient space, or R infinity, it will be, in fact, the L2 completion of the inductive limit of all the surfaces that are obtained from P2 by blowing points of the Neron Severi group of the surface tensorized by R. So the only thing you have to have in mind is that we blow up all the points and we want to identify, for instance, when we blow up the point P, well, we know that outside it's an isomorphism, so we don't want, or for instance, if it doesn't touch the line L, you want to identify the L here and the L here. So this is what we do just. And in fact, when we work, we don't want to determine in which model we work, but we do it all at the same time. And so this is an hyperbolic space. So if you then, inside this R infinity, you take the class such that C squared is 1 and C times the L is positive, then you have the analogous of this hyperbolic space, but in infinite dimension. And this is a complete. So And even if it's of infinite dimension, it is still Gromov hyperbolic, it is still cat zero because every condition around triangles. So you can always come back to H2. Okay, and our Cremona group act on this space. And we understand well the isometry of H infinity. So now I will just say things. So. So theorem, so the isometry, the isometry of H infinity. So let G be an isometry, then so we call it, so this is proposition definition. G is elliptic if it has bounded orbit. And this is equivalent to have a fixed point. Then we said that G is parabolic if G has unbounded orbit. And it fixes the point at infinity, a unique point. So the boundary at infinity of this are the class which have self intersection zero. Yeah, well. But it's well, if it has one, it has all. So, but it just, okay, if, let's see. Yeah. But if you have one which is unbounded, you have all. So it's an, it's the same. Yeah, it's an equivalence. But J is loxodromic if all or one unbounded orbit and it fixes, exactly one. And it fixes exactly two points at infinity. So loxodromic elements, they act as translation on the axis that link the two points. And the parabolic, they have one point, and the dynamic is in this way, and the elliptic, they fix a point. Okay, and in the case of the Cremona group, I didn't say, but the distance is really well related to the degree of the to the growth of the degree of your maps. So this can be rephrased for the Cremona group acting on these things. This can be rephrased by how the degree growth of your maps evolves. And just for the title, what is nice is that we exactly know which point for the parabolic. Well, we have two kind of parabolic cases. And we know exactly the form of the fixed point at infinity. So they are either of the form line minus a point that we have blown up. And this will correspond to the Jonquière group, you know, the one which preserves the pencil of line. This fixing this point tells you exactly that you preserve the pencil of line passing through the point P. And another kind of parabolic, they are the one of the form 3L minus EP1 minus EP9. And this tells you that you preserve the pencil of elliptic curves. So we have two specific kinds of parabolic, and we know that loxodromic cannot have the same endpoints as parabolic ones. And this is important. So now, let's go. So sketch of the proof. So
So we take let G be a subgroup of BRP2. If the characteristic is positive, we assume moreover that it's finitely generated. In this case, we go to a finitely generated extension of K that contains the coefficient of a finite set of a finite generating set of G. So G is finitely generated. So maybe on the prime field, not all these coefficients are on the prime field, but up to a finitely generated extension. So we can assume this thing. So this is why we need that G is finitely generated. And moreover, we assume in this case K to be a finitely generated extension. So if this is P of FP containing all the coefficients of the polynomial defining the element of a finite set of a generator of G, all the coefficients of the elements defining a finite given generating set of G. So now we are in this setting, and so now we do some cases. So the first case to consider is that if we have two loxodromic elements in our group, so if G contains two loxodromic elements that do not have the same axis. This implies, so for the Cremona group, it's not true in general, but for the Cremona group, this implies in fact that the endpoints of the axis are all disjoint. So you, in the Cremona group, you cannot have two loxodromic that share just one point at infinity. And this was done by Urer, not by Lamy, but Kanta did a case which was not existing in fact, but it was not so hard to deal with, so it was not a huge problem, but it has been affined by Urer. So this means that endpoints of the two axes are disjoint. So now we can play the ping pong lemma like Emmanuel explained it. So you have an axis of F, axis of G. You take small neighborhood of the point at infinity. And F will bring everything outside. So power of F will bring everything which is outside these things into. So this is the attractive point of F. This is a repulsive point of F. And then this is attractive for G and repulsive for G. So then you play the ping pong lemma and you have a non-abelian free group. So ping pong lemma. And this case is okay. So now we can consider a group that contains loxodromic elements, but they have all the same axis. contains at least one loxodromic element, but if more, well, and all loxodromic elements this implies that in fact so this implies that for any element in G they will have to preserve this axis, because if not by conjugation you will have a loxodromic which has not the same axis. So gamma, this implies that G preserve gamma, and so up to index 2 subgroup I want to avoid symmetries. We can assume that all they act as a translation on it, maybe with zero length, but so up to index 2 subgroup. We can assume that all G in G acts as translation. And so now we have a morphism from your group to R. To G, it sends this translation length on the axis. And you can look at the kernel of rho. It will be consisting of elements in G that fixes every point, that fixes pointwise the axis. And so either this group has a bonded, well, so either this group, so okay, so the quotient here will be abelian, so we are okay. So either this group is finite, and then we are okay. And if it's not finite, then we have to work more with algebraic subgroup of the Cremona group. And then you can find out that it will be conjugated to a subgroup of either Jonquière, no, sorry, either toric, either automorphism of P2. This is the game. And okay, then, okay, you have this, my time is over. So then you consider also the case where it contains a parabolic element. And then this is not so hard to deal. And the thing which is a bit more hard to deal is the elliptic case. Because you can have, in the non-finitely generated case, you can have torsion groups with unbounded orbits. And this is harder to deal with. But. I will stop. It was just to give you a flavor of what's going on. Thank you.